morning. We're starting on time today. All right. Well, welcome. If you've not been here before, welcome to the Ark Awakening Revival Center. We're glad you're joining us. It's a beautiful day outside. We try to let the light come in, and we're just going to kind of glorify the Lord, and then we'll get back outside and pray. I think we'll jump a little bit. All right. So I just want to go over a couple of things. We have people come in, and we talk about the app all the time, that you can get notifications of anything that's going on here at the Ark. We do have an app, and we send out notifications of something that's canceled or just reminders of times of things when we're gathering. And that is going to be My Ark in the App Store. It's free. And it just allows me to send out a blast to everybody that I'm kind of like their Bible. So if you just go into My Ark and download the app, that would be great. I will also let you know that we're having Bible study or prayer at 6 o'clock on Wednesday night. And anytime during that hour, that first hour, 6 to 7, you can come in. So people just kind of wander in and we have a prayer time. And then we have our Bible study at 7. And this week we're going to be in John chapter 3. And we're going to be in there. So I'll be sharing a little bit about John the Baptist. And then we also have coming before you know it, a Resurrection Sunday, which is the last Sunday in March, and where we try to do something a little interactive, so you need to be there. Right? And then we have Robbie Mitchell on the 10th of March, yes. So we have a guest speaker on the 10th, so please mark your calendars for that. And then please come and be involved in the Resurrection Sunday. We try to do a little feasting at the end, but we're going to do something a little different. And some of those girls are trying to get together with some ideas, but we want it to be everybody's involved in the ministry. And with that, I'm just going to open us up in prayer, and we'll just pray to the Lord. Everybody stand up, please. Lord, I thank you. I glorify you this morning, that you blessed us with even the breath of life. Lord, sometimes we let the things of the world creep in and weigh us down, but today we lay our burdens at the cross and we say, thank you, Jesus, for releasing us from the bondages of sin. Lord, that your grace is flowing amongst your people, that you've made a new way, that you brought freedom into our minds, our hearts, our beings. Lord, we come against anything in the house, Lord, against your people. Lord, may they come right now with open hearts, Lord, open minds to understand your word. We break down every wall or barrier that would block the word in this place in the name of Jesus. And we just come and we worship you. We say you are the Most High. You are the Lord of hosts. And that we humble ourselves before your cross today and say, thank you, Jesus, for what you're about to do, what you have done, and what you're going to do. In Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If you have had like a chronic pain, there's a good chance that you probably have had this kind of moment where you just hear the devil telling you, you're not going to get better. It's not going to get better. This is your life now. You better learn how to deal with it. It's not going to get better. If you really love him, he would heal you. If you really care about him, you'd be better by now. And man, I have grown my faith so much. For man, I would be lying if I told you that for a single man, he did not defeat me to make me feel so small. And I had to get up in his sin and I had to go, Lord, I'm so sorry that I let him get in my head again when I know that you're good. I know that you are for me. And even at first, I continue to pray. And when it feels like nothing's changing, I continue to seek you. And when it feels like I don't have anything left, I keep coming on my knees praying to you because I know that you have more for me than what I'm going through right now. So if you have been in that place, it is not a time for shame. I am not saying anything to judge you, but I am giving you the freedom right now to say, Lord, I'm so sorry that I didn't trust that you had me in mind. I'm so sorry that I didn't trust that you were pursuing my healing, that you were bringing that for me. And Lord, I just give myself back over to you. Cleanse my mind of Satan's word. Cleanse my heart of the doubt that I have, Lord, and restore who I am, that I know I am good and loved and cared for by you. Hallelujah, Jesus.
I'm holding on to you.
the desert will never be my friend.
Time for the rise of the church. He's a good God. Just shake your hands. About 500 people this morning. Everyone's got two hands. You have to do the best yourself. That was amazing worship. That was like off the hook mic drop. I don't want to drop the mic because it's expensive. All right, God is good, amen. That was fun worship today. Wow. I tell you, it just sounded good. The drums were amazing. Lacey, the singing, Joel, I didn't hear the guitar, but it was good. And if you had a Liberty, good job on that. Keyboard band, just amazing. God is good to be God. Let's take a little step forward. 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 This is so good. We're going to do a lot of time. We're going to have a good testimony this week. A good God testimony. Come on, man. Give it up here. Let's get right here. Let's go. I know it's probably going to be my job, but don't drop it. One day, God can change your situation. And one day, you can go from being the last to the first, from the least to the greatest. And one day, you can go from suffering with lack of more than enough. Because we serve the God of miracles. I want to increase your faith. A very prophetic word today. It's prophetic in your life that this will bring life into your situation. Give you a biblical example and talk about how in one day God changed the situation. Now, today we have time for provision, protection, deliverance, but there's healing, and one day there's anything God can do in one day. You guys believe that? So when this next came to me, I got so excited because I'm like, one day, what was limitations and weak points, and it kind of goes, and just before your breakthrough, you give up. That happens all the time. Because you know that tomorrow is your breakthrough, and you give it up to God. And so God's got a plan for you, and a lot of times we say, God, where are you in the plan? Amen? You know, a lot of times it's seasons. Sometimes it's not just in one day, sometimes it's in one season. Sometimes it takes no longer than one day. But all the time, that breakthrough in one day. Death's not a thing to fear, it's not a thing to long for, but it's not a thing to fear either. You just go through life and do the best you can, amen. You trust God, you love people, you love yourself, you obey the word of God, you do the best you can, and then someday when you get to that throne, you can say, well done, good and faithful servant. Because you only have to be obedient to what he calls you to do. You don't have to force yourself to somebody else's call. You don't have to make yourself operate like this person over here because God designed you to operate like you. There's only one you, one DNA that's coded to you. Amen? Individuality, uniqueness, creation, design, or purpose. And destiny. That's the only destiny of greatness. We've got to hold on to that because life has been so busy wrapped up in the world, we lose focus at the price. That's the job. That's the world's job, is to keep your eyes on the ground and keep you from looking at them. So, man, I want to talk about God's provision in one day. I'm going to tell you about a narrative in 2 Kings how the famine was so severe, they were being deceived by the spirits. It was so bad, so terrible, so severe that they were into cannibalism. They had to eat people to stay alive. That's how bad it is. Because they were trapped in the city, they couldn't go out and eat grass. There was no grass left in the city. Dirt, streets, and buildings. There's nothing left. But one day, God changed the situation. But sometimes you have to go through things to get to your one day. Sometimes you get pushed up to your limit, and it is no fun. Amen? I mean, it's no fun getting pushed to the limit, and you're like, God, if it's not today, just take my life. Thank you. Jonah. What side is known about Jonah? This is pretty interesting. We've been talking about Jonah a couple weeks ago. I guess we can expand on this a little bit. But there's an eclipse coming in April, the Greek Triple H. It's going to be the next question. Big eclipse, right? Okay, the Lord hears God saying, you know, what did he say? You know, 40 more days and then the judgment. I don't know, I'm not saying that. I just think it's true. I don't take anything for granted. God is my thing. He sets up everything. And so, I'm about to finish in 6 weeks. I'm going to all the way from Ohio, Great Columbia, all the way to Texas. What's the chance of being on a 100-mile-wide path and being in the cities of Nineveh? All of, I didn't know there were 6 cities in Nineveh in the United States of America. That's what 6 were on the path of totality. Just saying. But in one day, God can change everything. In one day. In one day, he might have to do it. Why do we make it suffer? Or wait, why do we make it possible? Sorry. I have wicked problems and they can bring it to their feet. But we don't pray for that. We pray for repentance. Because true revival is repentance. True move of God is people repenting. True move of God is not about one of the things. That's fun. I love that song we sing, like it's basically bringing back the oldies. Stuff we grew up on, that's the stuff that we have in church there. And it's a great song and it's fun. But true revival is about repentance. Repentance is about true revival. All right, 2 Kings 6:24, 7:20. Lord God, we thank you for the word today. And Holy Spirit, we ask you that you would just minister to our hearts today, that you would prick our hearts, get an understanding. We just take off everything that would be over our eyes and ears, that we could hear clearly, we could see clearly the truth of the word of God. And Lord God, our faith will be built up today. Lord, if the faith is so built up that there is nothing impossible to see or believe. Lord, I thank you for the people that are here, the people on live stream. We bless them. We speak encouragement. I say that, Lord God, that you are doing great things right now. And this is a wonderful season of your life. We love you, Jesus. Understood? Amen. All right, 2 Kings, I just read the whole thing. And it happened after this that Ben-Hadad, king of Syria, gathered all his army and went up and besieged Samaria. And there was a great famine in Samaria. And indeed, they deceived him and said, listen, a donkey's head was sold for 80 shekels of silver and 1/4 of a cow, which it would be, and a dove dropping for 5 shekels of silver. Now, obviously, you're like, what is the deal here? A donkey's head and a dove dropping. Why is that so significant? And so I had to look that up. I'm like, man, there's got to be something. Is there for a reason? And so a donkey's head, you know, obviously, is the leftover of the carcass. It's really like the best part, you know, like, wow, I just want to thank you for your donkey brain. But it makes you great to do, apparently, I haven't thought of it. Never will. I don't know. stuff up. He said, "Five, seven, he's still there." And I said, "What does that look like?" I read one thing that he's about to release. Don't think they're moving around much in the city. In this case, it was actually true. In dead droppings, you can just see as the dust went out into the field where they couldn't go because they were deceived. There could be some seeds in the droppings, maybe some medicine, maybe some nutrition. But it's bad, bad. So I just want you to see how bad the famine is. They are going to die. In fact, I will be on how bad it really is. Here's the thing that is over 26. As passing by the water, the woman cried out to him, saying, "Help, my Lord, I pray." Said, "The Lord is not helping me, where can I find help for you?" From the threshing floor, the wine press, and the king said, "Well, what is troubling you?" And listen, he answered and said, "The woman said to me, 'Give your son, and when you feed him today, I will leave my son tomorrow.'" Yeah. That's how bad the family is. I want you to just see how bad it is in Samaria at this time. "So he brought my son and ate him, and I said to her the next day, 'Give your son, and we will eat him,' but she has eaten her son." When the king heard the words of the woman at a poorest place, that's not breaking point. If he can't handle it anymore, they can point up to the very limitation of human sanity. "I can't take it anymore." Has anyone been in a place where you said, "I can't take it anymore"? Come on, can I hear a couple more amens out there? "I can't take it anymore. I am so tired of this happening. I can't make it anymore." It's okay to be in that place, or it's not okay to quit believing. I guarantee you, everyone here was praying to God. Now, this was a punishment for their idolatry. But no better way to turn a country around than defeating them and having them that hungry. Famine will bring you to your knees. It will rock everyone. Even a fighting man can't fight with it, not fed. They can't fight with you if you're not. Pour his clothes, and now he has sackcloth on his body, and he's fasting. And eventually, he doesn't get that far away. They said, "God, you say to be in love, that the Elisha was going to survive, and he was not here today." And Elisha already prophesied that Elisha was the prophet of God, and we came out to Elijah, that we're going to, and he did the miracles anyway, and the word of God. And he was sitting in his house. I want to talk to you about timing, okay? I want you to listen closely about the timing, because Elisha was sitting in the house. If he just heard this from these people, he's like, "I'm done, I'm killing Elisha, because he's really part of the process, because it's this God that caused these issues." And he said, the elders were sitting with him, and the king said, "A man ahead of him." But before the messenger came down, he said to the elders, he saw this prophetically. Elisha already knew what was going to happen. And he said, "Do you see how this son of a murderer has sent someone to take away my head?" God's timing is always on time. God set all this up. Your suffering is a setup for a victory. The things you go through is a setup to glorify God. Do you hear what I'm saying today? It's not to torment you or tease you. Sometimes you cause it yourself. Sometimes you're in a position because you're in a position because of the place you put yourself into. But it's okay because you can call out to the name of God. You say, "Jesus saved me," and he will. But it's always on the table. Because you may have to go through it or whatever. And one day, he said, "Look, when the messenger comes, shut the door and hold him fast to the door. Was not the sound of his master's feet behind him." And while he was still talking with him, there was a messenger coming down to him, and the king said, "Surely this calamity is from the Lord. Why should I wait for the Lord in the Lord?" Verse 7, then Elisha said, "Listen, hear the word. Listen to the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord, tomorrow about this time, a sayer of fine flour shall be sold for a shekel, and 2 sayers of barley for a shekel at the gate of Samaria." That was impossible to believe that people were actually even selling outside the gates of the city. They were on the siege. They couldn't even go to the gate. They would got stuck with an arrow. How could something like this happen in one day? Time and time again, people in front of my life all the time. And I still doubt it sometimes. I'm like, God, you can't do this. I just feel it. You just got to get your mind off the natural and get back into the supernatural. Because wherever you put your thoughts and your time and your energy, that's going to be your God. That's going to direct your path. If you put your time on the natural and listen to CNN and see how the world's going, and see how you have no money, you have no jobs, you have no income, you have no way to support anything, but one day God made it happen. And one day, when he said, listen to the word of the Lord. And I tell you, church, when we listen to the word of the Lord, then one day things are going to change. You don't have to be where you are today, tomorrow. You know what I'm saying? Everything can change in one day, but it takes the word of the Lord and puts belief, faith. And instead, an officer, verse 2, on his hand, came in there, speaking to God, and said, look, if the Lord could make the windows of heaven open, how could this thing be? Natural human response. How many times have we responded the same way? How could this be? How many times have gotten prophetic words and said, that's impossible, that will never happen? That's not going to happen. There's no way. It's the way we respond to the situation. It's the way we... Are you going to turn to the flesh and fear, or are you going to turn to God and have faith? Because I'm telling you, things ain't going to get easier, but they will get better. Because you have to know who your God is. You have to know what the word of the Lord says. You have to know what you stand on and what you believe. Because you may be rocked, and the people around you may be rocked. But when your feet are on solid ground, you can't be shaken. And although the world is shaking around you, and it looks like quicksand, and everything's sinking and going down, you stand on the word of God. Literally, I have stood on the word of God, and I declare the praises that are in it, and my circumstances have changed in one day. I'm not saying it's a formula. I'm saying it's the way of God. This is how it is. You want to talk about kingdom? You better understand how the word of God works, because that's the kingdom. The kingdom of heaven suffers violence. You know why? Because people don't understand how it operates. They take a lot of beatdowns and abuse for really no reason. Because we have to respond with everything that the word of God is. What did Jesus do in this temple? I mean, three times he said, it is written. It is written. It is written. How are you responding? Are you saying it is written? Are you saying your right or left? Because whatever you partner with becomes your new ally. And so he said, because of the servant's lack of faith, he said, in fact, you shall see it, but you shall not hear it. Because the doubt. The doubt will steal your faith. It will steal your faith. It will steal your in-one-day supernatural miracle. In fact, in this case, the pastor is right. Your declaration of faith determines your outcome. Let me say that again. Your declaration of faith determines your outcome. You know, we make a lot about faith, but faith is something that you don't walk with your eyes in the natural. You have to walk with God in the supernatural. So just trust him. No matter what, you just trust him. In other words, that's why I told him so, verse 30, now the four lepers met at the entrance of the gate. And they said to one another, why are we sitting here until we come? If we say we will enter the city, the famine is the city, we say that again. And if we sit here, we will die also. Now therefore, come, let us surrender to the army of the Syrians. If they keep us alive until then, if they trust us, then we will die. That's about right. That's about right. Yeah, we're dead either way. Maybe we're not dead going this direction. They still got food out there. But they had to leave their comfort zone. Because they were comfortable with the game. They were finding babies sitting in the cave. They were dying. But they were too afraid to leave the comfort zone to take a step out and see what God had for them. That's a word for some people today. You got to leave the comfort zone. Nathan, do you have to leave the comfort zone? Sometimes you do. But guess what? It's uncomfortable. That's what they call leaving the comfort zone. So you leave it, and then guess what? Now you're saying, Lord, here I am. What do I do? And now you're floating in the current. The Holy Spirit takes you wherever we need. And that's the best place that you ever could be. We're not good. Comprehensive, we're still going to be. true room that Gehazi, which was the wife of Philip, I just remember the story of David, who he came in and he said, he's from the and Elisha said, you know, I haven't got paid for it. He wouldn't talk to him. He came in with gold and silver and clothes and all kinds of stuff. He said, I just talked about David with him 7 times. And he was like, hey, come on, wait a second, do some hocus pocus over me. Do something magical, or make it into a formula. And he said, if he asked you to dip, doesn't it make more sense to go cleanse yourself in the river? And so he didn't like the Lord, he liked the rest of the guy. So here he dipped 7 times, 7 times he came out with leprosy. It was a miracle. Gehazi, he was the right servant at the time, he just said, hey, you know, he's the king goes, or the servant, that's Gehazi, the man, he goes, what can I give you guys? Anything you want, but all this food is, I want nothing to do less. He's coming straight from the dead. And he's asking her to talk to the guy. And that's how dirty he is. So God has everything set up. Because of this obedience, God has it. Which, however, but when you're in obedience and you just do what God gave you, you don't have to worry about these things. You don't have to worry about tomorrow. You don't have to worry about tomorrow. Keep working to the time of his life because he's never going to do it. And so when you're relative to twilight, you go to camp. When they come to the outskirts of the Syrian camp, to their surprise, no one was there. That's a big surprise. An invisible ghost army, they didn't know. They could hold up. Who knows how long they'd left, right? Families think it's part of that now. And so, verse 6, the Lord had caused the army of the Syrians to hear the noise of chariots and the noise of horses, the noise of a great army, so they said to one another, look, the king of Israel is powerless against the king of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to attack us. Therefore, they arose and fled at twilight and left the camp intact. Their tents, their horses, their donkeys, they fled for their life. And these lepers came to the outskirts of the camp, they went into their tent, and ate and drank, and carried some silver, gold, clothing, and went and hid them. Came back to their tent, carried something there also, and went and hid them. Now, it's so awesome that God takes the wealth of wit and gives it back to the people of God. Come on, I mean, I know I say that all the time, but I'm telling you, there's a wealth in this kind of place, but you've got to be obedient to receive it. You have to get out of your comfort zone to see it. But if you get out of your comfort zone, you're going to bring a whole bunch of other people into joy. When you get out of your comfort zone and do what God calls you to do, the other people are going to be like, wow, we can go too, and they'll follow you. It takes a few people to make the way. It takes a few people for a faith that to give the path to the other people. A few leaders that will have a vision that go forth and say, I'm going to get out of my comfort zone and do it. I don't like doing it. In fact, I don't even like being up here right now, but I do it because of obedience, because this word is going to change some lives in this place today. And my goal, my heart, is to see you change and transform the image of Christ. That is the mission right now. But when you step out of your comfort zone, people are going to be watching going, wow, look what you did. And they're going to follow you. So they said to one another, we are not doing right. This day is a great day of good news. If we remain silent and wait until morning light, some punishment will come upon us. That's a good thing right there. You go in your comfort zone and you see that you're being blessed and things, great things are happening. Don't just say it all to yourself. Start sharing the joy, amen? Share the blessing, man. Be like, hey, check it out. Look what's over on here. Check out what's on the other side. Look what's in the land of good and plenty. This is a great place to be. Let me show you how to cross the river and get there. So the king rose the night and said to his servants, let me tell you what sins have done this. Now, this is going to be what happens when you use natural thinking for a supernatural revelation or experience. He said, this is the experience. They know where we are hungry, therefore they have gone out to hide themselves in the field. I mean, that's a valid point. Saying when they come out of the city with their pets and alive, they get into the city. since I walked into the city. And so verse 13, one of the servants answered and said, please let several men take 5 remaining horses, which are left in the city, not 5 horses. This is a do or die moment. This is like live and ride, baby. Either we go out to the stream to get trampled and killed, or we do it. This is a true story. And so they took the 2 chariots and they sent theirs to the Syrian's army and said, go and see. And they went out to them, verse 13 to 15, and it was Jordan. Indeed, all the road was full of darkness and weapons, which the Syrians had thrown away their head. Even the weapons were taken away. They were hungry. And the people went out, the message to Jordan in verse 16, the people went out and plundered the tents of the Syrians. So listen, the word of the Lord. They have 5 flowers and sold for a shekel, and 2 stands of barley for a shekel. According to what? The word of the Lord. The word of the Lord. If you need to be a leader, will come true. There is things that are going to be happening according to the word of God. But there's also the blessings of God that are in your life that are also coming to pass. Time to be a work changer. This is all coming to me. This is what we're talking about. Just coming in. The words is the revelation that comes to us, because he wants to tell you some things about him. He wants to get you back on track. He says, my people are being destroyed for a lack of knowledge. Because my people have no vision and they are perishing left and right. They don't know where to look anymore. They go to this church, they go to that church, they go to this church and another church, and they can't find what they're looking for because they're not settled on the word of God. They're looking for an experience. They're looking for it make me happy, make me feel good. But the truth is if you're in God's problem in here, ain't nobody going to make you happy but Jesus Christ. Ain't no church going to be a perfect church. Amen? And I hear an amen. I've been with you myself. I haven't found one yet, even the ark. No perfect church is. There's people that come together and love you for. Love for as much as you say. Amen. This is the fulfillment of the word. The king had appointed the officer on his name. He had been back in the trenches. But the people trampled him in the body of the king. Just as the man of God said. Who spoke when the king came down to him? So it happened just as the man of God spoke to the king. He stayed in a body for a shekel. He stayed in a flower for a shekel. So he spoke around about this time to taste the marriage. I'm telling you right now that tomorrow something will happen in your life. That tomorrow can be in one day. And one day can be any day or day. It's like, it could never happen. Don't ever say that because it can happen. It could happen. All things are possible to him who believes. There is nothing impossible for those who are in Christ Jesus. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You just decree the word of God and has action. And when you decree the word of God and activate, the devil does what? Whoa! He's out of town, baby. He wants nothing to do with a believer that quotes the word of God. Because what do you do when Jesus started quoting the word of God? He left. He said, I'll wait for a more opportune time. When you quote the word of God, it's never an opportune time for the devil. I'm telling you, you gotta hear me today. When you speak the word of God, the devil flees. He cannot be around the word of God. The word of God is just like the manifesting of Jesus. He can sing the word of God. This is the vision. 2 Corinthians 9:15. God will generously provide what you need. Then you will always have everything you need. Thank you that you will share with others. Like Pastor Scripture said, they share freely and give generously to the poor. The good things will be remembered forever. Verse 10, for God is the one who provides seed to the farmer, the bread to eat, the same way he will provide and increase your resources, and then produce a great harvest of generosity in you. See, the problem is a lot of people are just wanting for me. Me, myself, and I, the Holy Trinity. The totally direct opposition to God. You know, when it's you, the Holy Trinity, you will not operate as the king of heaven designed you to operate. Your design is reflect. That's designed you to operate. That's me, me, me. But when you're generous, you're going to be a great harvest. A great harvest. And how many of you need a great harvest in your life? Amen? We need bread. Be generous. Now, doesn't mean give all your money away to poor. That's just foolish. You got to be smart about it. These are the poor you always have with you. What you got to do is be strategic and mindful. You pray, Lord, how should I do this? What's it? Invite the Holy Spirit into every aspect of your life, even in the desert. What should I do, Lord? He will tell you what to do. Because some seed is worthless when you give it out. There's some ministries that don't have any good fruit. And you get to them, you're like, well, $1,000 and you'll break the back of poverty. Have you ever heard that? Yeah, right. The problem is that one's trying to assume the motion. And so what you got to do is you got to invest the Holy Spirit in everything you do. And be generous. If you're at a gas station and says, go fill that person's trunk with gas, they do it. They do it because, that's what you never know where that person's going to. There are people all around you right now that put on this fake facade of everything's well, everything's okie-dokie. But then the reality is they're hurting and broken inside. They put on like, I'm making it, and deep down inside they're crying out. And I'm going to say mothers and answer. But mothers, you can't go wrong with love, amen? Yes, just about you will be enriched in every way. This is always the difference. And when you take the gifts to make me, then what does it do? The two good things will result in the ministry of giving. These are believers in Jerusalem with that, and you will give to express and give thanks to God. As a result of your ministry, they will give glory to God. You hear what I said? As a result of your ministry, as a result of your ministry, as a result of your ministry. Every person in Jesus is a minister, okay? I may be an ad minister, or like at this level, but everyone's a minister of Jesus Christ. Don't wait for me to do it. Don't expect me to do it. Don't put on a pedestal like I can do it. You need to go out and do a few things. And the reason why the church has not grown, and the church has been stale and stagnant, and people are tired of the church, and going to Wiccan and going to witchcraft because that supernatural experience they receive, the reason why is because the church is powerless. Because no one wants to act like a minister, they want to act like a taker. They want to be a consumer of the Word of God. Well, guess what? You consume the Word of God, but at some point you better give it back out again, because if you don't give it out, then you're just going to rot inside, because the oil flows out. You need to be anointed, and the anointing needs to go in and out, in and out, in and out, in and out. So that we're empowered to people. Because this is the time. This is a God-ordained time right now. You are literally in a God moment in your life. You are called, chosen, destined, set apart for Him, and purpose to be in this place today. Why is He using this? I don't know about that, but I know it is because you have a job to do. There's a group of people around you that work at the hospital in. There's people that come in sick. Now, it's hard to do that in some jobs. Doctors don't like you preaching the gospel, am I right? They don't like the name of Jesus. They like the name of money. Hey, you need chemotherapy. Don't do Jesus. We got to get back to the healer. We just trust the doctors a little too much. I'm not downplaying the doctors. They're good. I thank God for doctors. Hey, go to a doctor. If you got a problem, go to a doctor, but get a second opinion from the Word of God before you take care of things if you're going to die in 15 days. We just had a lady here Wednesday that she said, I'm going to die. She goes, when my blood vessel aneurysm pops, I got 15 seconds to live. It's terrifying. It's terrifying. Is it though? I have a hard time feeling sorrowful because all I can think of in my mind is to be asking from the body to be present with the Lord. I'd much rather be present with the Lord than here in the body. I don't care how much good stuff I have. It's not going to keep me down from the good things of heaven that are way beyond these little earthly things. If you took the word of the doctor to heart, and you do that, you need to make sure you get a second opinion from the Word of God. Because the doctor will heal you. As a result of your ministry, people will get glory to God. Your generosity to them, and to all the other believers who prove that you are obedient to Jesus Christ. are you obedient to the things that Jesus Christ did? I'm going to challenge you. I'm going to kick you a little bit. I'm going to poke you and prod you because this isn't going to be a comfortable place. Can't be. It's time to get moving. It's time to get doing something. Christian, you've been talking about doing destiny for a while. It's time to get moving. I'm not saying it's a word for the Lord. I'm just, you know, kicking you. Not why you're going to move on. But he has a passion and desire. He doesn't want to do it yet. But I'm telling you, if you can start assisting people and help start these ministries and let them be the ministers of the gospel, then this is just a good feel-good service time. This doesn't have to be a, you know, to this, you know, I don't want this to be a motivational speech. I don't want it to be a feel-good ministry. You don't want to know what I was doing and Monday the same thing happens. I want this to be in one day your life changes. And one day you're in a position to receive the blessings of God. You're no longer closed-fisted, but you're open-minded. You're no longer narrow-minded, but you're open-minded to the things of God. And you're no longer saying, I can't do it, but I can do it. Because as soon as you start saying, I can, and all things are possible, and I believe, and I trust in Jesus, those kind of things change your atmosphere. You know what doesn't, you know what else changes your atmosphere? I don't know if we can do it. I can't believe this is happening. We're going to be in big trouble. We'll never be able to do this. That will change your atmosphere, too. Because whatever comes out of your mouth starts to affect your atmosphere. And that is true. It's happening. You see bad things? Yeah, bad things start to manifest. You see good things? Good things start to manifest. What do you want to manifest in your life? God fights the battle, you're protected. You know that he's always protected you? If you knew, when you get to heaven and you find out how many chances there were to take you out, especially every young adult male between the ages of 14 and 22, come on. I'm like, I mean, like a bunch of times where I was sort of dead. We're young boys and just stupid. We go out and we're like, we have that I can't die mentality, and we actually put God to the test on that. And the famous stuff in my high school, I went to school prep, that in our high school, we had multiple deaths. It was kind of tragic of all of our friends that were dying. You know, a lot of it was drug related, like cancer. But God was protected, and it does protect you. And I want to show you how to so we're going to take a second chronicle this point. Let's read the Bible to you. I love the iPad. It's pretty cool and handy. It's really awesome, but long. Maybe it's just over 155 minutes. It's just, it's kind of like, wow, it just feels like a weapon. An iPad does not feel like a weapon. I'm like, oh, it's just like on the sixth, but oh, it's a little bit crazy. Distraction. Weapon. There is a difference. But like we said, there's a difference. Think in fact, my life. If you use that, I don't like that. But if you read it, you read the Bible. I'm going to get you out of that. He's read that and he goes, we don't see the Bible says. I'm just trying to figure out how to read that thing with those F's and S's. It's like, what is the deal with English? It's changed that much in 500 years. Everything is different. I mean, the music, the words, the letters. But anyway, that's the Bible. The word of God is every day. So it happened. So the people of Moab were the people of Ammon and others with them. Besides the Ammonites, the battle of Israel was fought. This is one of my favorite narratives about it because it shows that one day God could change the circumstances. So we talked about provision, but we're going to talk about protection again. And so then King Solomon, verse 2, I told Jehoshaphat, saying, a great multitude is coming against you from beyond the sea, from Syria, and they are against Tamar, which is a young gal. Now think about this. You're just enjoying your time in the city. It's a beautiful day. And you get word that some giant army that you didn't even know about is coming to attack you out of the blue and rolling right over there. of Asaph in the midst of the assembly. And he said in verse 15, "Listen, all you Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and you King Jehoshaphat, thus says the Lord to you, do not be afraid nor dismayed because of that multitude, for the battle is what? Not yours, but God's." How many times have we tried that? The victory of our collective power. We can do this. Do you know that God wants you to fight in any tribe or event? It's totally okay to bring every little thing to God. You're not bothered at all. He loves it because it'd be like telling your life and telling your kids, here's what I did today. Here was my day. He wants that personal relationship with everyone. It's not like if God is a savior, but you don't need to be telling on him to save us all the time. But that's just kind of love on him, like, in a different place, isn't it? Because what he does. He's always doing good. So now, I want you to look at the prophetic. Because this, how many know that prophetic word can change your life? Sometimes when you're down and you get a beautiful prophetic word that says, God says that tomorrow you will, whatever it is. And then, it's good to get a prophetic word, but it's also good to check that word and know where it came from. It's good to get a prophetic exhaustion. But it begins to begin to sweat. And so you need to be very balanced on how you do that. I've seen people that they just need to have a prophetic word all the time, and they're seeking more of the word from somebody else than they have the word from the Lord. Okay? I'll tell you right now that all your information is found right here. That word, the prophetic word, should be a confirmation of what you're doing. If it tells you, the Lord says, don't do this, you better just kind of wait and get a word from the confirmation word to make sure that you're supposed to do it. You will not need to fight this battle. Seek the salvation of the Lord who is with you, O Judah and Jerusalem. Do not fear or be dismayed tomorrow brought this day, for the Lord is with you. And one day, they found out that they were going to be dismayed, basically. They were prepared, but they didn't have the wherewithal to even fight this vast horde of army coming after them. But they fasted, they prayed, the word of the Lord came, and they said, and see your God work today. And that's what you hear that you see your God work today. You need to fast, you need to pray, you need to stand still. Don't let him move. Let him fight the battles. Let him be your victory. Let him move you as he makes necessary. So they rose early in the morning, almost the best part of the day. The Levites of the children of the Kohathites, and as the children of the Kohathites, to praise the Lord. So he said, "Oh, Judah, Jerusalem, do not fear, be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord is with you." There's some times that God's going to tell you to do something. You have to face it. They had to go out. He said, "You will have to fight the battle, but you have to make an appearance. You won't have to go out and actually bring the sword and defend yourself, but you'll have to go out there and just make an appearance and say, I trust the Lord my God." This is part of getting out of your comfort zone. You don't have to go out and make an appearance, but God's going to fight your battle for you. You don't have to justify yourself worrying about people speaking against you. You don't have to justify. You say, "Lord, fight my battle for me. Be as honorable and obedient as you can. I say, Lord, I'm standing and I need you to fight this battle. I need you to be my victor. I need you to be my God and my Savior." If you would do that. And finally, they had to start worshiping the Lord. There's not much to get to. But with that, you guys are the children of the Kohathites. And the children of the Kohathites. The poor man. To praise the Lord God of Israel for his love. So they rose early in the morning, went out to the wilderness to tell us, they went out to his fast, and said, "Hear me, O Judah, and the inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe seen your Lord, your God, at this Sabbath gathering. Let me just speak this over you today. Believe that the Lord your God, and you shall be established. Believe his prophets, and you shall prosper. Believe. Just believe. Just believe. Just believe. We think so hard. We're thinking about a whole bunch of rules and regulations and duties. So just believe. It's so simple. The gift of heaven is to be with grace. It doesn't require you to do anything but believe. That's pretty exciting, right? I know that this is how I was thinking about that because no matter, I don't have to do anything but believe. That takes a lot of load off. I can still have a burden relief. I'm like, I don't have to do this. No, I just have to believe. Then you have to be obedient. You don't have to leave out your tongue. You don't have to fight the battle because the battle is the Lord. You don't have to worry about provision because the provision is coming from God. You don't have to fear these things. You don't have to worry about these things. You don't have to dread these things because the Lord your God is God. Because in one day, he's going to change the situation. In one day, he's going to change it. But you've got to believe, 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 believe. And these guys were worshiping as well. Because when you believe, you can worship. You know why? Because when you believe, you don't fear. When you believe, you have faith. When you have faith, you know that God's got you. And when you know that God's got you, you feel like praising the Lord. So sometimes it is a sacrifice to praise the Lord, amen? Sometimes it's hard to get up there. I love you, Jesus. Oh, I know you're so good, you're going to make a way. When you don't even believe it, but you just have to believe it. But sometimes you got to stand enough times when you finally hear it, and you start to believe it. Thank you, Jesus. Sometimes you have to. Yes, because sometimes the Word of God is so bad in your life that you have to speak the Word of God so you can believe it again. Because the devil's going to steal your joy. He's going to steal your peace. If you open any door, he's going to be right there to crack that door open and pass it and kick it in. So you've got to be on guard against the devil. And it takes faith, belief, and trust in God. And these, I hope these narratives drill home that one day God can change your situation no matter what. It may look bad today, but it could be a breakthrough tomorrow. It may look bad at the moment, but God's making a way. But you've got to believe it. You've got to believe it. You've got to trust that you can do it. Get out of the way. Verse 22. They began singing and praising the Lord, saying, "Help us to make the people." Who set the verses? The Lord. I'm going to come against Judah. It's about people. It's not about performance. It's not about routine. It's not about schedule. It's about us. It's about you. We have to keep that in mind that we can start now and get out of there. We don't keep pushing on the schedule. We're not going to be a party service. feel ready to grasp the kingdom of heaven that we've ever seen. And you're a part of it. Just you being here today, I understand the place you come here is going to happen to us all in America, but what I can say is that that's our focus here. We're not about growing the church, you can tell. We're going to tell you the word, say from the word. We're going to give it to you straight, but guess what? You're ready for it. The days are not forever. They give me, and I knew, because if you really know, my wife has been doing this. We always turn them off up there, so I never hear Ralphie playing. He doesn't know that, but he'll tell him. Because the church has been vegetables far too long. And the church wants to be a vegetarian, but they don't want to go with the meat. But the meat builds protein, it builds stamina, and it's strength. And it's not time for the church of God to arrive and to be an amazing church that has the protein to do with and the strength and the stamina to go on with it. Because these are days that are going to be like crazy kind of damage. And you don't have to worry about it because you can be in the best season of your life. No matter what goes on around you, your life is not dictated by the world. I'm not saying you don't pay the penalty for some bad choices from government or bad choices from family or death. But sometimes there's like a penalty for being associated in that system, but you don't abide there. You're that problem. Your mind is too big. That's what we're going to get down to. How about this? If you come out here, I'm just going to read over the Psalms one second. Oh, yeah. Oh, wow, that was awesome. Wow. Let's give it up for the worship team. Yeah. I tell you, that's been amazing. You've been very organic and nature. You've gone through a lot of things to y'all. You've just had to make those things. Whatever God brings is who he brings, and you're here for a reason. And we have, of course, the worship. As far as we don't have a worship team, we have to have 20 people. And if you're the actor, you know, we didn't have to really, like, stay there and keep doing it. We've always sat here for, like, 6 months and never wanted to. It's like, I don't know what to do. Was it here? But one day, he said, I want to play the drums. We want to abide in a place where you can function and flow, where we want to support you in the ministry because everyone here is a minister. Like your grandpa, but if I can see that everyone is a minister and they all have importance in the kingdom of heaven, there's no one more important than you. It's not about just like these people are up here, it's like you guys are a part of it. That's what I'm saying, that we're going to write to you for the Bible. I'm just going to read this over to you while I'm going to read this over to you. Psalm 97. And this is a lot to me because the Lord told me out of a lot of situations. He's delivered me from financial peril. He's delivered me from all kinds of different types of battles that we've been through. We've been through a lot. You know, I look back on that one. We've been through quite a bit. We're more than the average person. But when you're a business owner, and you're a minister, then you really get the, you really get the double whammy effect. And so, can't say this is the first few times, but I'm just going to read it over here. If you can just close your eyes and just listen. Give thanks to the Lord for He is good. His faithful love will be with forever. Has the Lord redeemed you? He still can. Tell others He has redeemed you from your enemies. For He has gathered your silence for many years. Our peace and wealth will be found. Some wandered in the wilderness, lost and homeless. Hungry and thirsty, they grew to God. Lord, help! They cried in their trouble. And He rescued them from their distress. He led them straight to safety to a city where they could live. Let them praise the Lord for His great love and for the wonderful things He has done for them. For He satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. Some sat in darkness and deepest gloom, imprisoned in added chains of misery. They rebelled against the words of God, scorning the counsel of the Most High. That is why He broke them with hard labor. They fell, and no one was there to help them. Lord, help! They cried in their trouble, and He saved them from their distress. He led them from the darkness of deepest gloom. He smacked their chains. Let them praise the Lord for His great love, for the wonderful things He has done for them. For He broke down their prison gates of bronze, and He cut apart their bars of iron. Some were fools, they rebelled and suffered for their sins. They couldn't stand the God of food, and they were knocking on death's door. Lord, help! They cried in their trouble, and He saved them from their distress. He spoke out His word and healed them, snatching them from the door of death. And let them praise the Lord for His great love and for the wonderful things He has done for them. Let them offer sacrifices of thanksgiving and sing joyfully about His glorious acts. Some went off to sea and ships, climbing the great routes of the world. They too observed the Lord's power and action, His impressive work on the deepest seas. He spoke and the winds arose, stirring up the waves. Their ships were tossed to the heavens and plunged again to the depths. Their sailors screamed in terror. They reeled and staggered like drunkards and were at their wit's end. Lord, help! They cried in their trouble. He saved them from their distress. He calmed their storm to a whisper and filled the waves. What a blessing was that stillness as He brought them safely into harbor. Let them praise the Lord for His great love and for the wonderful things He has done for them. Let them exalt Him publicly before the congregation and before the leaders of the nation. He changes rivers into deserts and springs of water into dry, thirsty land. He turns the fruitful land into salty wastelands because of the wickedness of those who live there. But He also turns deserts into pools of water, the dry land into springs of water, and He brings the hungry to settle into builder cities. And so their fields, plant their vineyards, and harvest their bumper crops. How He blesses them. They raise large families there, and the herds of livestock increase. When they decrease in number and become impoverished through oppression, trouble, and sorrow, the Lord pours contempt on their faces, causing them to wander and suffer suffering. Then He rescues the poor from trouble, and increases their families like flocks of sheep. The godly will see these things and be glad, while the wicked struck silent. Those who are wise today will take all this to heart. We will see in our history the faithful love of the Lord. Lord, His Son gave us cry out to Him in your sorrow. Cry out to Him in your distress. He calms the storm. He fills the waves. Call out to Him for He satisfies the thirsty. He fills the hungry with the good things. Cry out to your trouble, and He rescues you from your distress. Give thanks to the Lord for He is good, and His faithful love endures forever. Come on, let's stand. Feel like today is just a change, a transformation. Today is a turning point in your life. Things don't have to be the way they've been. Because in one day, He wants to change your situation. But you must call out in the name of God. You must worship. You must pray. You must declare the word. And you will see those things that troubled you start to fade away. Those things will start to disappear out of your life. For you have good things in store for those who love you. Good things in store for those who worship him. Good things in store for those who partner with him, trust him. And most of all, believe that he will do what he says he will do for you. And then one day, everything's going to change. And one day, your life will be over. And you're going to say, well done, good and faithful servant. And you're going to say, away from me, for I never knew you. That's a choice that you make sure that you know today. It says, confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. Believe that he is raised from the dead. Admit that you are a sinner and you shall be saved. It's not a magic formula, but you have to believe. But once you believe, you have to seek him. You have to seek the knowledge of him through the word of God. And you're here today, and you know you have a time to get out of your life. It's time to step out. It's time to get out of your comfort zone, people. It's time to wake up. The church has been asleep for 2 decades. It's time to wake away, go sleeper. It's time to get out of the comfort zone because it's not about tickling the air. It's about you changing the world around you. You are called to be a world changer and a transformer. And you are called to move the kingdom of heaven violently. But it can't happen when you don't want to step out. Fear. You're a liar. Death has no hold on you. Sickness has no hold on you. Even poverty has no hold on you. Because when you're in Christ Jesus, then you become his child. And those are the child of the Lord. That he's going to let just fall down. And you may be in willful rebellion, but it's time to come back to the Lord. You may say, well, I don't know about all this. Today's your day to make it real. It's time for commitment. Most people are ready to commit. They don't want to do what it takes to commit to be the minister of the kingdom of heaven. Because you have to die your flesh. You have to let go of the things that perhaps you even love. But I promise you this, and gives you things that you will love even more. And what you're holding on to is worthless, earthly garbage. What he's called you for is for a higher purpose. He said, seek my face in the kingdom of heaven, seek my righteousness, and then all those things will be added unto you. See, your rewards in heaven, your treasure is not of this earth. So in 30 days, we sing this last song, that you be real. It's time to get more real than you've ever been in your life. Transparent. Let the veil come down. Let the blindness come off in the name of Jesus. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that you're freeing the people this morning. That, Lord God, that there is an impartation from heaven that is coming down on the people of God. If that's you today, just raise your hands in this place. That, Lord God, there's a fire coming down from heaven. That you're burning out the dross, Lord God. You're burning out the old man. See, the old is gone, and the new creation has come. Lord, see that the new creation, Lord, will go into the highways and the byways. Let that change for our region. Lord, I thank you for every business represented here. Lord, I speak favor over it, blessing over it, prosperity. And Lord God, when you bring in the new God ideas, God revelations, that we can work half as much and make twice as much. For Lord, it's not time to wear off the saints. It's time to be about the Father's business. Lord, I thank you that you you are imparting the gifts on your people that they were born with, that they're being unlocked in the name of Jesus. Lord, thank you that you're unlocking the gift of prophecy, the gift of healing, the gift of the word of knowledge. Thank you, Lord, that you're unlocking, Lord, those heavenly gifts that you gave your people to use in these days, in this very day, in this very hour, that they may destroy the works of the devil and this very kingdom, Lord God, that they trample on snakes and scorpions and not get hurt, they can drink deadly poison and not get affected, that, Lord God, they may change in the atmosphere, that nothing will touch them, and to those who believe, Lord God, they may be added to their number daily. Lord, may it be about the soul of the kingdom. Lord, may you change our very mindset from ourselves to others. May you change from a selflessness to a selflessness. Lord, today we just ask for forgiveness of what we made church, the way we made church. Lord, we want to see, Lord, the fresh oil, the new wine. We want to see, Lord God, the glorious appearing of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, we invite you to press in this place. We want to have our ears open and our eyes open that we may see and hear the voice of the Lord. And that, Lord God, that we will get out of our comfort zones and that we'll be not reactors, but actors, Lord God. We will go out and we will be the one of action, oh God. I thank you that in one day, to change in the situations that are represented in this room, whether it be health or finances, or whether it be personal warfare, even in our family, Lord God, we decree right now the wholeness of the family, where we call the family to come back intact. Lord, those things that were a division and divisive, we command to come down in the name of Jesus, by the blood of Jesus. Lord, we speak over those situations and build reconciliation and restoration. That, Lord God, that what the devil's intended for harm, you're going to turn around for good. That there's a testimony coming out of the families that said, look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done, for he is good. He is good. We praise his name forever. Come on, start praising his name. Because in the praise and worship, the breakthrough is. Where there's praise and worship, there's a release from heaven. Where there's praise and worship, there's a closeness to the Holy One, to the Living One, to the Creator. Come on, praise the Lord today. Lift up your voice and praise him. You're good, Lord. You're good, Lord. You're good. You're a good God. I'm telling you, everything's changing today. You are not the same person you came in today.